is asleep. Judas is betraying. But Sunday's coming.
It's Friday.
Pilate's struggling. The council is conspiring. The crowd is vilifying. They don't even know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are running like sheep without a shepherd. Mary's crying. Peter is denying. But they don't know that Sunday's are coming. It's Friday. The Romans beat my Jesus. They robe him in scar. They crown him with thorns. But they don't know that Sunday's coming. It's Friday. See Jesus walking to Calvary. His blood dripping. His body stumbling. And his spirit's burdened. But you see, it's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The world's winning. People are sinning. And evil's grinning. It's Friday. The soldiers nailed my Savior's hands to the cross. They nailed my Savior's feet to the cross. And then they raised him up next to criminals. It's Friday. But let me tell you something. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The disciples are questioning what has happened to their king. And the Pharisees are celebrating that their scheming has been achieved. But they don't know. It's only Friday. Sunday's coming. It's Friday. He's hanging on the cross, feeling forsaken by his Father. Left alone and dying. Can nobody save him? Oh, it's Friday. But Sunday's coming. It's Friday. The earth trembles. The sky grows dark. My king yields his spirit. It's Friday. Hope is lost. Death has won. Sin has conquered, and Satan's just a laughing. It's Friday. Jesus is buried. A soldier stands guard, and a rock is rolled into place. But it's Friday. It is only Friday. Sunday is a coming.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin and dwelt among men. My example is he. Hands that healed nations stretched out on the tree, took the nails for me.
Living, he loved me, and dying, he saved me, and buried, he carried our sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day.
One day they led him Gethsemane's mountain, and one day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, and bearing our sin, our Redeemer is he. Hands that healed nations stretched out on the tree, and took the nails for me. In living he loved me, in dying he saved me, in burying he carried our sins far away, in rising he justified. Could not keep him from rising again. Sins far away, and rising he justified. Thankful for his resurrection this morning, aren't you?
Yes.
Amen. I'm thankful that it's not about the Easter Bunny. I watched and I smiled as my little baby boy got his Easter basket this morning. It was filled with candy, and every little piece of candy he'd pull out, he'd say, I want that. But I'm thankful this morning it's not about the Easter Bunny, it's not about the candy, but it's about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I'm thankful that he died on the cross for my sins, but I'm even more thankful that he rose on that third day to give us hope this Easter morning. You listen to the words of this song, because of his resurrection, I am redeemed.
Bye.
Still I live in a foreign land. Oh, but now I'm free according to redemption's plan. And soon I'll join the road and mark the redeemed. We'll sing a song holy angels cannot sing.
I am redeemed. I am redeemed. Jesus loosed the chains of sin and set me free. I am redeemed. I am redeemed. Jesus loosed the chains of sin and set me free.
Think about it. Some glorious morning they will come from all nations. And from every generation, side by side, they will march into that celestial city of Jehovah. And in perfect harmony, they will begin humming a new song, a song composed by God, arranged for His children as a saved by grace approach the land of their dreams. The host of heaven will step aside. Even the angels will be silent, for they cannot sing this new song. For it is a song reserved for the voices who once cried out for the Redeemer, those washed in the precious blood of the precious Lamb of God. Be here than any place I'd know.
Yes.
Wouldn't you? Amen. I know it's Easter Sunday and we got a lot of family and friends here with us this morning, but if this is your first time ever to First Free Will Baptist Church, if you can just slip up your hand, we got some ushers with a visitor's card that we'd like for you to fill out and drop in the offering bag as it passes in a few moments. Thank you guys for helping us out with that. Anybody in the balcony? Maybe it's your first time here at the church this morning. Or anybody else here on the main floor that we've overlooked? If you can, just slip your hand up really, really high. All right, church, let's give them a hand and make them feel welcome.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I looked at Brother Lucas, and he didn't know what I was doing. I said, are you ready to throw the outline of the service away today? He said, let's go for it. Where you at, Tim? Come on up here, buddy. During the morning service, the 7 o'clock service, we had a young man, young teenager get saved. And then this is Tim. Tim, tell him what the Lord did for you.
I got saved again.
Bless him, Lord. He don't understand yet. He's young. But you only get saved one time. And a lot of people, they'll take a profession of faith that never stuck. I'm glad, Tim, you can have a possession of faith. And that's the Lord. Amen. Are you proud of him for taking that step? Bless you, buddy. You know, we could shut down shop and say it's been good already. And I was back there in the back just trying to keep my composure about how good God is and what God's doing. All of you look so nice in the balcony, main floor. You look, choir singing better than I believe I've ever heard them sing. The Spirit of the Lord's here today. Leslie, come on. Let's do this blood, okay? I meant to ask her the other day, but I don't know how in the world that we could have service today without her singing this beautiful song.
Oh,
that try to hide that precious blood that gave me life. But in 3 days, he breathed again and rose to stand in my defense. So I come to tell you he's alive, to tell you that he dries every tear that falls. So I come to tell you that he saves, to shout and to proclaim that he's coming back for you. So I come to tell you that he saves, to shout and to proclaim that he's coming back for you.
We've sung this a lot during the revival, but it's so fitting for this morning. And because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and God is more than living just because he lives. Let's sing that chorus again. And because he lives, is more the living just because he lives. And life is more the living just because he lives.
Amen. Amen. It's so good to have all of you here on Resurrection Sunday, the day that Christians set aside as we observe the resurrection bodily and spiritually of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's good to have all of our visitors today. Would you give them a hand for being with us? Thank you. Hope you feel welcome. If it's your first time here, just want to let you know we do have children's church. If you need that, just ask one of the ushers right over here on this section. There's a cry room right there. If you need to go in there and sit with your child and nurse the child and mother, feel free to do that. Let you know the bathrooms are out the middle doors, the men's to the right, ladies to the left. And also, if you'd like to join the church here this morning, you spoke to us about it, would you come forward at this time if you could do that? Bless you, brother. Amen. Can I hear a motion to open the doors of church?
Brother Moderator, make a motion to open the doors.
Can I get a second? Second by Brother Jim. Thank you, Brother Joe. Come on up here, brother, sister. Amen. This is Brother Kenny and his precious wife that we've just grown to love and appreciate them. And I'm going to let them tell you why they want to join the church.
First, I'm going to say thank God for a threefold cord. I thank you for blessing me with a Christian wife and a Christian family. We just want to join to serve the Lord.
Amen. Sister Gayla?
I love the Lord, and I feel at home here, and I want to be a part of here.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, give them a hand. By your right hand, for those members, if you agree to take them in, raise your right hand and say aye. Any who oppose? All right, can I hear a motion to close the doors of the church? Thank you, Brother Brandon. Brother Donald, second that. Doors are now closed. I'm going to give you right hand of fellowship, Brother Kenny, Sister Gayla. We love y'all. God bless you. How about it for this precious couple? Amen. Have our ushers come receive offering this morning. We just wanted to make sure that we got that in now. I can cut my sermon short if I need to, but at the end sometimes. Don't y'all like the way that we took in members this morning a lot better? You like that? I do too. That's three of you at least. God bless you. Going to ask Brother Scotty Baker if he would come bless offering at this time.
It's good to be here this morning, boy. Sure been a good morning. Lord's blessed. Let's go to prayer. Our most kind, gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for another privilege. Lord, we thank you for that sweet Holy Spirit we feel here this morning. God, I just pray that you'd go with us through the rest of the service. Be with Brother Chris as he stands to preach. Be the choir as they sing. God, I pray for this offering that you'd bless it, use it for the uplifting of thy kingdom. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Saves you, babe. Yes, I'm in.
This morning, give Sister Leslie a hand as she sings for you.
walking on the road to Jerusalem. The time had come to sacrifice again. My two small sons, they walk beside me on the road. The reason that they came was to watch the lamb. Daddy, Daddy, what will we see there? There's so much that we don't understand. So I told them of Moses, Father Abraham. And then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb. There will be so many in Jerusalem today. We must be sure the Lamb doesn't run away. So I told them of Moses, Father Abraham. Said, dear children, watch the Lamb. When we reached the city, I knew something must be wrong. There were no joyful worshipers, no joyful worship songs. So I stood there with my children in the midst of anger. Crowd cry out, crucify him. We tried to leave the city, but we could not get away. Forced to play in this drama, a part I did not wish to play. Even now they come. The first one cried for mercy. The people gave him none. The second one was violent. He was arrogant and loud. I still can hear his angry voice screaming at the crowd. Then someone said, there's Jesus. I scarce believe my eyes. A man so badly beaten, he barely looked alive. Blood poured from his body, from the thorns upon his brow, running down the cross, falling to struggled. I watched him as he fell. The cross came down upon his back. The crowd began to yell. In that moment, I felt such agony. In that moment, I felt such loss. Until a Roman soldier grabbed my arm and screamed, "You carry sword." So I knelt and took the cross from the Lord. I placed it on my shoulder, Golgotha. They drove nails deep in his feet and hands. Yet upon the cross I heard him pray, Father, forgive them. Oh, never have I seen such love in any other eyes. And to thy hands I commend my spirit, he prayed, then he died. I stood for what seemed like years. I'd lost all sense of time, till I felt two tiny hands holding tight to mine. My children stood there weeping. I heard the oldest say, Father, please forgive us. The lamb ran away. So I took them in my arms. We turned and faced the cross. Then I said, dear children, watch the Lamb.
Wasn't that wonderful? Matthew chapter 27. I did not talk to Sister Leslie, although she claims me as her brother, and I claim her and all her sisters and her sweet mother, who's able, who had back surgery just two or three weeks ago, and she's been able to be back in service twice. Amen. Isn't that wonderful? She didn't know that I was going to be preaching on this subject, Watch the Lamb. And she sung that song. We didn't converse. And you talk about giving confirmation. And I'm glad Brother Kyle got back. He went on an errand for the Unity Revival. And I got to thinking some church done picked him up to preach this morning. He said he was close. Matthew chapter 27, you stand for the reading of the Word of God, verse 33, starting in verse 33. I wanted to read a lot larger portion of Scripture today, but for time's sake, we won't do that, and you just go back and read it today sometime. It'll be a blessing to you. Verse 33, and when they were coming to the place called Golgotha, this is to say, a place of a skull, they gave him vinegar to drink mingled with gall. And when he had tasted thereof, he would not drink. Many scholars say that this was a cheap wine that they tried to give the Lord, and he would not drink it. The Bible says, and they crucified him and parted his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet. They parted my garments among them, and upon my vesture did they cast lots. And sitting down, I want you to underscore that verse if you have a pen or highlighter, verse 36, and sitting down, the Bible says, they what? Watched him there. And sitting up over his head was the, set up over his head was the accusation written, this is Jesus, the King of the Jews. And they began to mock him. People began to wag their heads and shake their heads and mock him, saying, hey, you saved others, save yourself. They walked by and they said, oh, he says he can tear it down and rebuild the temple in 3 days. Well, go ahead and show us how much power you have. Now, I want you to go on to verse 54. Now, when the centurion and they that were with him What's that say? Watching Jesus. Saw the earthquake and those things which are done. They feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God. Amen. And I may talk on that a minute. I heard Brother Hoy preach the other night. Brother Bobby and Angela did probably one of the finest sermons I ever heard in my life on what made that centurion believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Now let's skip on down to verse 65. Pilate said unto them, you have a what? Watch. Go your way. Make it as sure as you can. So they went and made the sepulcher sure, sealing the stone and setting the sepulcher sure, sealing the stone and setting a what? A watch. I want to preach this morning just as fast as I can on watch the Lamb. Let us pray. Kind Jesus, Lord, we love you. God, we thank you for your grace and mercy. God, I pray, Jesus, Lord, that you bless us now. Bless the reading of your word. God, above all, if there's more here today that needs to be saved, may they be saved, Lord. Thank you for the two precious souls, Lord, that bowed, Lord, and said, Lord, forgive me of my sins. And God, I pray that there be others today that would do the same. God, I pray, Father, that you bless, Lord, the sermon. And God, I pray that you bless the one, Lord, that'll be speaking today. God, I pray, Jesus, you anoint me from the top of my head to the sole of my feet. Anoint my stammering tongue and my lips of clay. God, may the message be clear. And God, I pray, Jesus, may we all receive a blessing. May we walk from here, as David said, saying, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. God, we'll praise you for all things it's done. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the sweet, sweet Holy Ghost, and all God's people said. Amen. And you can be seated if you can. In verse 36, and sitting down, they watched him there. As I began to study on this subject this week, I'm reminded of Abraham in Genesis chapter 22 as he took Isaac and the two of them began to make their journey to a mount called Moriah. And the two of them headed that way. That matter of fact, many believe that Mount Moriah was actually the place where Jesus was crucified. And Isaac, on the way, he asked the father, he said, behold the wood and the fire, but where is the sacrifice? Or where is the lamb? You know the story as well as I do, most of you. And once he got to the top of that hill, he bound his son. There was no refusal. And what was going on, there was no fighting back at all. And he took a knife. He was getting ready to take his son's life. Whenever the voice of God spoke from heaven that said, hey, lay not thine hand to thy son. And praise God, aren't you glad that God had provided while the sun was going up on one side of the mountain? There was a ram coming up on the other side of the mountain. And about that time to when that knife was going to take that boy's life, that boy, the promised seed, the promised child, the one that brought laughter, that's what Isaac means, laughter. Laughter had come to the home of Abraham and Sarah. But now he's taken that son, he's trusting God. But might I say this morning that Abraham never would have done it if he didn't believe in a resurrection. He never would have took the first step. And there God provides a lamb in the thicket. Its head is caught in the thorns. A perfect type and shadow of the Lord Jesus Christ. I couldn't help but think also of how I'm reminded of John the Baptist in John chapter 1. In verse 29, as John the Baptist stood in the chilly waters of Jordan that day and cried, behold. What is he saying? He's saying, what? Watch what happens. Whatever you do, don't miss this. Vicky, he said, watch the Lamb. Thank God. He said, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. Amen. We as Christians, we We have watched the Lamb through the Scriptures. We've watched the Lamb as the Lamb slain before the foundations of the world. We have watched the Lamb through the Old Testament in the book of Exodus becoming our Passover Lamb. We've watched the Lamb as Mary's little lamb. Mary had a little lamb whose fleece was white as snow. And everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go. Aren't you glad that you've got a lamb that'll walk with you to the end of the world? Thank God he sticketh closer than a brother. He'll never leave you. Hebrews 13:5. He'll never forsake you. But there we've watched the Lamb born in Bethlehem and laid in a manger. We've read further in the text and watched the Lamb grow up in the carpenter's shop. We've traveled to the wilderness with the Lamb before his baptism there. And we've watched the Lamb as he fasted and prayed for 40 days. We've watched the Lamb as he would heal the widow's son, that widow of Nain. He touched him and the boy sat up, and thank God he ate after that. He began to speak. We've watched the Lamb, bless God, as he opened up the blinded eyes. We've watched the Lamb as he cast out demons. We've watched the Lamb as he healed that woman with an issue of blood on his way to resurrect a daughter 12 years old. 12 years a woman battled the issue of blood, and he's going to a girl's house that's 12 years old to raise her from the dead. I don't know about you, but I never get tired of watching the Lamb. We watched the Lamb from a babe in a manger to a baptism in the middle of the Jordan to bearing a burden in the Garden of Gethsemane where he sweat great drops of blood, the Bible says in Luke 22:44, great drops of blood. Why were they great drops? Because he was praying a great prayer. That was the result of a great plan. Bless God, from a great God with great purpose, where a great sin debt was needing to be met in order for a great salvation, thank God, to be purchased by a great Savior on a great hill. Thank God. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for the Lamb, and I'm going to keep watching the Lamb of God. Hallelujah. In Luke 23:14, the Bible says, "You have brought this man unto me as one that perverteth the people. And behold, I, having examined him before you, have found no fault." No fault in this man touching those things whereof ye accused him. The trial of Jesus Christ before Pilate was a farce. No one had ever suffered so much injustice in all their life. Notice three things with me quickly under the vilification of Christ. In Luke 23:2, and they began to accuse him, saying, "We found this fellow perverting the nation." Note these three things. Number one, the seriousness of the charge. Perverteth the people, the Bible says. They brought this charge. Listen, this was more than a slander. This was a serious charge that was coming upon Christ. And it says he corrupted the people, twisting the facts and led the people astray. Actually, it was the religious crowd. It was the accusers of the Lord who were guilty of perverting the people. The accusers were the very culprits that were causing this to come upon Christ. Not only do we see under the vilification of Christ the seriousness of the charge, but then number two, we see the supposition of the charge. He said, "You brought this man unto me as one that perverteth the people." They did not present any evidence for their accusation. Not one thing did they have to bring against Jesus Christ for evidence. See, if they would have even tried to bring some evidence, they would have been embarrassed because there was none. That's right, There was no evidence here. The supposition of the charge, it was crazy. And so we saw the seriousness of the charge. But then number three, and we'll move on, the size of the charge. The religious leaders started it. they started this charge and were able to enlist a large multitude to help in their cause. Young person, listen, don't follow the crowd. Okay, the crowd's not going to lead you in the right direction. Amen. Matter of fact, if you want to do what's right, then you stay faithful to the house of God. Amen. Stay faithful to prayer. Stay faithful to reading your Bible. Amen. Stay faithful to witnessing to your friends at school. But the crowd got behind this. And have you ever noticed about how the crowd works? I mean, you're in America. You know how the crowd works. You just get a small group of people starting to make a lot of noise, and they'll end up making the bit larger crowd do what the smaller crowd wants them to do. We see it all the time in America. Well, you know what? I'm hoping from right here in Hayesville, North Carolina, that revival fires burn to where people see a little smoke and they have to come just to see what's going on. I don't know of anybody that's ever went to watch water freeze into ice, but praise God, you get a fire going. I'm telling you, people will come from everywhere. They'll come with lights blinking and horns blowing, whistles whistling, and they'll come in here. There'll be people drive up just to see what's going on. Let us burn, Lord, in your glory. May the glory cloud grow. May people come. May they see there is a God, and he's alive. He's well. He's sitting at the right hand of the Father. He's not been vilified anymore. He's been verified, thank God, as being the Lamb of God who paid our sins debt. The vindication of Christ. See, the court of Pilate, number two, was a strange one. It vindicated Christ, yet it condemned him to a cruel treatment. Such are the courts and the critics today. See, out of one side of their mouth, they speak favor and truth. Out of the other side of their mouth, they speak lies. I believe James said this: a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. That means saying one thing and doing something else. That's about politics. Can I get a big amen? Amen. Doesn't matter what side of the fence you're on in politics. Listen, they have a problem telling the truth. I'm glad I'm not a politician. Praise God, I'm an old-fashioned, God-called preacher filled with the Spirit of God that'll tell it just like it is. And if the devil don't like it, he'll have to get over it sometime, 3 or 4 million years from now, because he'll still be in the lake of fire burning. And I'll still be strolling on Glory Avenue, amen. That's where I'm going to be. But this vindication, they call tolerance for diversity, but it's really corruption of character. We note three ways that Christ was vindicated by Pilate's court. Number one, the occurrence of the examination. Now listen, Pilate said, I have examined him. He questioned. He reasoned within himself of all of his responses. Pilate is watching the Lamb. As he watches him, Pilate had many faults, but to his credit, he did examine the Lamb. Pilate was a politician, but he did look this man over. Why? Why? Because he wanted to know the truth. Too many don't even take the time to examine the Lord Jesus Christ. They do not check out truth to see if it's true. They make their conclusions without an examination. Now this week me and Callie saw these girls, and I went to talking to these young teenage girls, and I saw them looking at my older boys, the twins, and they were laughing. They were laughing at them. And so I decided, you know what? I'm going to go over there and talk to those girls. But I made my daughter stay with me. You know why? I didn't want to get accused of something. That's just the world you live in. You got to be that way, right? And so I took my little girl over there, and my little girl's trying to leave while I'm dropping the gospel bomb. I said, whoa, no, you come back here. Well, I'm going, Mom. I said, I don't care. Stay right here. And so I began to talk to those girls, and I began to tell them about how much Jesus loves them. We're standing right outside the hotel building there, and I'm giving them the Lamb. And I look at the one girl, and I said, have you girls ever been saved? And one girl said, well, I have. And I said, would there be enough evidence for you to be guilty? And she had to think about it. But that other girl beside her, I said, young lady, you ever been saved? She said, no, sir. I said, do you feel the Lord speaking to you? She said, I sure do. I said, would you like to know Jesus in salvation? She said, yes, sir. I said, well, we'll pray right here. And she said, okay. She said the sinner's prayer right there, people walking by. Man, it didn't bother her a bit. She just got saved. In that small segment of time, she was able to examine the Lamb enough to know that her life was empty without him, and she wanted an abundant life. She wanted a fulfilled life. She wanted eternal life. And so she accepted the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, yesterday, I talked to another lady. And this lady began to tell me about how that, oh, yeah, I'm saved. And anybody just says, oh, yeah, I'm saved, you can pretty much take it to the bank that they don't know the same Savior that I've got. Because when somebody asks me, are you saved? Oh, let me tell you about it. Let me tell you how good God is to me. Let me tell you how that he pulled me out of sin and he took his blood and he washed me clean. She rejected, one received, one rejected. We all have a choice. Before you leave this service today, thank God we still believe in giving people an opportunity. Hey, today two guys come up to me and say, hey, I need to be saved. I mean, that's a lot easier than me going out. But sometimes I just like to think that when we go out of our way to go tell people about Jesus and we get told no, and it is frustrating, and sometimes you get cussed out, sometimes you get fingers pointed in your chest, sometimes you feel like you have no self-esteem left, and spiritually you feel like you're about to sink, but then all of a sudden God sends people to you to where you ain't got to go if you'll just go do what he told you to do. Hallelujah, you missed your chance to shout right there. We've got to go. If anybody's got to go, we got to go. We've got to. We spend so much time in everything, in every facet of life, but so little in going in the name of the Lord and telling someone that Jesus loves them and desires to save them. Number two, the openness of the examination. The Bible says before you, unlike many examinations, this one was no undercover. It's all out in the open. It was honest. There was nothing hid. It focused on the facts. Pilate's wife came to him and said, have nothing to do with this just man. Don't do it. She said, for I have suffered many things in this day in a dream because of him. This is one time that this man should listen to a woman. Amen. I mean, I'm telling you, he should have said, yes, ma'am. But he didn't. So the outcome of the examination, he said, still, even after the religious priests are crying out, Caiaphas is like, man, he's a crybaby, and he's crying about, what's happening here? It is a political move because Jesus is gaining fame throughout the holy city. And the religious crowd couldn't handle it. And so what they did, they backed him in a corner. And Pilate said, I find no fault with this man. And the only way you can find fault with Jesus Christ is to lie. That's the only way. That was all lies. Every bit of these accusations upon the Lord was a lie. And if you find anything wrong with the Lord, then it's a lie coming from you. Why? Because the Bible says in Hebrews 4:15, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Did you get that part? Yet without sin. He's there before Pilate. You're the king of the Jews, you say that I am. They knew. He was like a lamb led to the slaughter, yet the Bible says he opened not his mouth. He's meek, he's lowly, he's humble, he's not, they don't understand it. And anyway, we want to hash this out. Listen, he's going to die anyway. He's going to pay our sins debt anyway. He's going to do that. Matthew 27, verse 24, the Bible says, when Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but rather a tumult was made, He took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See you to it. Then answered all the people and said, now listen, I wouldn't have cried this. This shows you how wicked this generation was. His blood be on us and on our children. Then released Barabbas unto them, and when he had scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. You want to know why Jesus got scourged? Has anybody ever thought, why did they beat Jesus like that? Anybody want to know? Just raise your hand. It's okay. It's open. It's an open forum right now. Let me tell you why they did. Number one was for our healing. Number two, it was because it was prophesied by the book of, by the prophet Isaiah. And number three, Pilate was having him beat like that because he thought maybe if they just see him beat like this, he won't have to die. Right. Isn't that amazing? That Pilate was thinking this way. If I just have him beat to death, it was called the little death, where they were beat halfway to death. Many of the times, most of the men died during the beating of this. You've heard me preach it before, where literally this cat of nine tails, these nine straps of leather with bone and metal in it, would come around and tear the abdomen open and their intestines would fall out. Many of them would have to walk around after this scourging, holding their insides in themselves. Now stay with me a minute. They release Barabbas. Barabbas was a murderer and a thief. He was known throughout all of Israel being a devilish man. But have you ever thought about what Barabbas means? Barabbas means son of Abba. He's supposed to be a son of the Father. But he's a murderer and he's a thief. And I don't know about you, but according to the Bible, if we break one law, we're guilty of all of them. I was a Barabbas, but thank God for the begotten that came and blessed me with salvation, that I would not have to suffer. He's suffering for me. Now the Bible teaches us in verse 37 of Matthew 27, and I'm almost finished, stay with me. And he set up over his head this accusation written, this is Jesus, the what? The King of the Jews. This was written in three different languages. Number one, it was written in Latin for the Romans. Number two, it was written in Greek for the Greeks. And number three, it was written in Hebrew for the Hebrews, because this was in the Holy Land. The major three languages of the world at this time, up over his head was this sign, this inscription that said, this is Jesus, King of the Jews. Now, Caiaphas and all the religious crowd, they said, you got to change that. You got to take it down. He said, no, that which is written is written. You know what he's doing? He's actually taking a stand. He's saying, hey, I've gone as far as I can. I'm not changing that. Now, in studying, watching the Lamb, what's getting ready to take place? What feast? Passover. Passover. We had the Lord's Supper this morning early, and we'll have it again this evening. I'll tell you more about it in a minute for those that couldn't be here. But listen, there would be hundreds of thousands of lambs that would die. During this time, they would bleed, and the sins of that family would be pushed forward another year. Is everybody with me? Okay. People from everywhere are coming. Now, with all these lambs, if you got, I leave kids places. I can imagine keeping up with a lamb. You have enough kids, you will too. Somebody say amen. Could you imagine all these lambs being brought into the holy city to be sacrificed? They're just going everywhere. And sometimes, get a hold of this, sometimes a family's lamb got lost. Now, could you imagine what that did to those that believe in Judaism? at that time. They were having a modern age definition of a panic attack. Because on that lamb was going to pay for their sins, and they were going to be all right for another year, Brother Philip. So what they did is they took a string around the lamb's neck. And around that lamb's neck, they put a little bronze tag that had the family's name on that tag. And that way, if the lamb got lost, then it could be turned into the priest. And even though the family wasn't there and they didn't know about it, that blood would still be shed for that family, and God would know it. Even though the people might not know it, they could rest at night knowing that their family's sins had been atoned for by the Lamb. That's good, isn't it? Pilate had no clue what he was doing. When he put that sign over the Lord Jesus' head, what he was saying, this is King of the Jews. This is God's Son. This is Jesus Christ, the Anointed One, and he's going to die, and he's going to shed his blood. Thank God, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that who said? Son of Abba? Son of the Father? Listen, where one was named the Son of the Father, he did not get to die. But there was the real Son of God, hallelujah, that took the place of Barabbas, but he also took your place and took my place and took the sins of the entire world that we might be made whole in Christ. Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful? Up over his head, that inscription, Jesus, King of the Jews. This is he. Oh, glory. Let me close with this. The victory of Christ. Not only do we see the vilification of Christ, and we see the vindication of Christ, but the victory of Christ. 1 Corinthians 1:18 says this, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it is the power. Can you say power? Power. Look to your neighbor and say power. Power of God. You know what the devil don't want you to know? You've got power with God. The devil don't want you. Hey, you young people, look up here. The devil does not want you to know that you can have power with God Almighty. He does not want you to know that. But you do have that power whenever you get born again. The cross in Colossians 1, 20 and 21. And having made peace through the blood of his cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, and you that were sometime alienated in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled. Oh, I'm glad I've been reconciled. I got redeemed and then I got reconciled. Praise be unto the Lord. Boy, I'm telling you, I'm feeling the Lord right now. And then the Bible says in Romans 5 and 8, but God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You might say, well, preacher, I got to get some things cleaned up before I get in that church house. No, you don't. Hallelujah. Praise God. If you see a man on the side of the road and he's been in a car accident, he's bleeding from every part of his body and he can speak, what's he going to say? Well, let me get cleaned up before you take me to the emergency room. No, that man's going to want to live. He's going to want somebody to help him. In the time of my life, when I was broken and when I was bruised and when I was dirty and when I was down and when I was discouraged and when I was depressed and when I was sinful and sick as sick could be, I'm glad that the King of Kings came by, the Lamb of God came by, and he took me and he stuck his hand out, and I took his hand and I said, Jesus, save me. He took his blood, bless the name of the Holy God and he washed my sins away. I'm free. I'm free. I'm free. Thank God I'm free in Jesus Christ. And the Word of God says if we're free in Christ, we're free indeed. Honey, I want to tell you something this morning. Thank God I got under the spout where the glory runs out. I got plugged in. Bless God, he came to live within. I'm free. Hallelujah. I'm free. I'm going to shout it. I'm going to sing it. I'm going to testify. I'm going to tell it because I've watched the Lamb. Hallelujah. Woo! I've been holding that in for 20 minutes. Thanks be unto God that he can save anybody. Anybody that calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, why would Jesus, the perfect, spotless, unblemished Lamb of God, do such a thing? You ready for this? Because of you. He loves you. He loves you in spite of yourself. He loves me in spite of myself. He loves me. Matter of fact, when he saved me, he lifted me. He labeled me. He loosed me. Thank God, I'm telling you, I got it all. Hallelujah. In the Lord Jesus Christ. Now listen, there can never, Brother Kyle made mention part of this morning. Matter of fact, when he got done, I said, you preached my sermon. He said, well, I'm sorry. He said, but that's all I can do. And I said, I know, that's all I can do. Just preach it. But listen, there can never, ever be a healing without a sickness. There can never be a victory without a battle. There can never be a death without a birth. And there can never be a resurrection without a death. But thank God the Lamb of glory, the Bible says he gave up the ghost. He died. He didn't swoon. He didn't pass out. He died. Why? For our sins. The centurion watched the Lamb. In Matthew 27:54, now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things which were done, they feared greatly. And the Bible says, saying, truly, this was the Son of God. What would make a man that had been trained as no other man had ever been trained, seen the most brutal things that had ever happened to the flesh of a man, what would change this guy's mind? You ever thought about it? What in the world, this man that had crucified thousands of people, now what would change his mind? Number one, his composure. There was no struggle with the Lord. He just laid down. Number two is compassion. Whenever he's there, he's not. The people are cursing him and they're spitting on him. And he says, Father, what? Forgive them. They know not what they do. And number three, whenever he saw what was happening with creation, the sun shut her eyes and refused to shine. Matter of fact, one scholar put it like this. It was such a holy moment in history that God pulled the curtains of time between heaven and earth, and the sun couldn't shine and nobody was going to see it because it was a transaction between the Son and the Father. The earth quaked. The earth began to shake itself off its axis. The rocks rent. The veil in the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, meaning we have access to a holy God. We don't need another man anymore. We can walk right in the Holy of Holies anytime. Many of the dead that believed on the Lord resurrected and appeared under the city. That's why he's a conqueror, a centurion, a conqueror. Even the devil had to watch the Lamb. Isn't that good? Jesus conquered death, hell, and the grave. And Matthew 28:6 says, he's not here for he is risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. There's a comfort in John 16. Thank God, the comforter. He said, it's expedient for me to go away. He said, for if I go not away, the comforter will not come. Well, guess what? The comforter has come. There's not only a comfort, but there's a coming. In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7 says, behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him. They also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. And he'll say, I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, saith the Lord, which is, which was, and which is to come, the Almighty. He's coming. I said, he's coming. Hallelujah. He's coming. Bless the Lord. But there'll be a glorious appearing. There'll be a second coming. I'm glad, thank God, that we have a risen Savior. I'll close with this. A missionary in Turkey wished to teach a group of people the truth about the resurrected Christ. And he said, I'm traveling and I have reached a place in the road that I must make a decision. He said, there's two ways. I look for a guide and I find two men. I find one dead and I find one alive. Which road do I take? And the people, they said, oh, the living, they cried, the living. Then the missionary looked to him and said, why send me to Muhammad, who is dead, instead of to Christ, who is alive? I don't know about you, but I'm not looking for anything dead. I'm looking, and I'm watching, and I'm waiting for the Lamb. But as they come get a song, let me tell you, when he comes back, he won't be a lamb. He'll return as the Lion of the tribe of Judah. I said just a few weeks ago as I preached on Come Now, Let Us Reason Together, saith the Lord, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be made white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. The first time, they crowned him with thorns. But the next time, thank God, we'll crown him King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The first time he came, he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. But the next time, thank God, he'll ride out of heaven on a white horse and the armies of heaven will follow him. Amen. It'll be different the next time he comes. Thank God the first time he came to a cross, but the next time it'll be a coronation day. As you bow your heads all over the building, if you're convicted in your soul and you've never been saved, could you just raise your hand and say, preacher, pray for me. Is there one? Is there one in our midst today? I'm unsaved. Pray for me. Or at best, if I died right now, I'm not sure I'd go to heaven. Man, woman, boy, girl, be a good day for you to come to know Jesus. Could you just slip it up? Is there one? I'm not saved, preacher. What about this? I've been saved, but I'm not living like I ought to live. And the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me today. Would you pray for me? I'm not going to embarrass you. God bless your hand. Someone else? Just slip it up. That's me, preacher. I've been saved, but I'm not living my life that's pleasing unto the Lamb. Pray for me. Is there one? Another? What about this? I'm saved. I'm living the life of a Christian, but I need some direction for my life or maybe my family. I'd like for you to pray for me. Could you slip your hand up? God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Kind Jesus, you saw the hands and you know the needs. And God, I pray that you just bless in this place today. It's been such a wonderful service. God, thank you for the two souls that chose the Lamb. And God, we pray for others that might need prayer, need a touch, or even didn't have the courage to raise their hand for salvation. I pray that you speak to them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. And all God's people said, amen. As we stand together all over the house, if you need to come pray, come now. Yes, would you come?
Hello.
God bless her. Bless this one. Oh, thank you, Lord.
Would he?
God bless you.
That saved
others, you need to pray. You just come on.
For such a worm as I.
At the cross, where I first saw the light and the burden of my heart roll away. It was there.
Thank you, Lord.
Amazing.
God bless you, Jesus.
Grace I know.
Yes.
And love beyond.
God, touch Michelle. Touch Cheryl, Lord.
At the cross, where I first saw.
How many of you remember getting saved? What a day. Church,
the debt of
love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do.
At the cross, where I first saw the light. And the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight. And now I am happy all the day. At the cross, where I first saw the light. And the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight. And now I'm happy all the day.
Ask our ordained to come as we pray over Tony. Michelle, you want to come stand in for Cheryl? Tony's right leg's giving him trouble, and Cheryl's Michelle's sister-in-law Cheryl had a major stroke, and I talked to her husband Tommy. He said, "This is all I got." And I'm glad that we know a man who can. If you don't believe, we always ask you step out. But we just common people. We just believe the Bible. That's all we can do. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Oh, dear Lord, we come before you. God, we know what your word teaches, and God, these people have stepped out on faith right now. God, we pray for Tony's right knee and ankle, Lord. God, we speak healing into this leg. And God, your word says that he was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace was upon him. But with his stripes we are healed. God, touch his right leg right now. We believe, Lord. We believe. We touch and agree, Lord, that you will. God, we pray for Cheryl right now. God, sometimes we don't understand, and God, we wonder. But God, I pray you get glory out of this some way, form or fashion. God, we speak healing, Lord, into Cheryl's body right now. God, may this blood be taken off her brain. God, we pray, Jesus, that you would just touch Tommy. God, I pray, Father, Lord, that you comfort this family right now as only you can. Lord, we touch and agree right now that you'll touch her. God, that you'll help her, Lord. God, we pray, Jesus, Lord, for our brother. Lord, that you touch him when he has hip surgery this week. Oh, God, you're able. God, we believe, Lord. We believe. We touch and agree, Lord. We put all these cares, Lord, and countless others in the congregation, Lord. We call out for them right now that you meet their needs. Lord, we ask it now in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, Lord. Bless the Christian Unity Revival this week as never before. God, touch our schools. Give us strength. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Give him praise, church.
At the cross, where I first saw the light, in the burden of my heart rolled away, it was there by faith I received my sight.
Such a great day. Amen. We love all of you. So glad that you're able to be with us in service. I'm going to have our ushers stand at the exit doors whenever they go out. And what they're going to do, they're going to give you a postcard. You take as many of those postcards as you want, because we have 5,000 of these. And what this is, and especially our students. Now, today at 5 o'clock, we're doing a 5 o'clock student rally, a youth rally at 5 o'clock. It's going to be from 5 o'clock to 6 o'clock. It's going to be an hour of power. That's what we're calling it. So if you're young, we want you to come, because we're going to receive the Lord's Supper again this evening for those of you that couldn't be here. That's just something that I felt led to do, because some of you have children, you can't get here, or some just couldn't make it for whatever reason. So we want to offer that to you this evening. But these postcards are very important, okay? Very important. And also, if you can help tomorrow, if you can help tomorrow morning before school, what we're going to do, I already talked to Brother Kyle, we're going to contact the principals, and they should not have a problem with this, because down here on the bottom of this, it says sponsored by Fellowship of Christian Athletes, okay? So we're going to be able to give these out. The only time, kids, the only time, according to the law, that you cannot give these cards out is during instructional time, okay? That's against the law. In other words, pay attention in class. All right. After class is over, hand them out to all your buddies. But we're gonna get the four-way stop going in Yellow Jacket Street. And I know we got one principal over here that will help us in Hiawassee. And we want to get these in every student's hand. Okay. So we've got pastors coming in this evening at 5 o'clock. It's going to be here. But parents, friends, youth, whatever, 5 o'clock. If you can't be back, then you take 25 or 30 of these, or 50 or 100, and pass them out at your school. But we do need Union County represented, Towns County represented, Clay County, Cherokee County. I know we got some Fannin County represented. We gotta do our part. You remember what I said in the sermon about sometimes God honors when we do our part? Maybe we don't win the souls, and God says, I'm just going to send them to you. So by giving someone this, they can see where it's at. They can follow us on Facebook. They know the dates. They got a phone number they can contact, website. And also on the back, it's got the service times, and it says, from pastors who care about you and your family, because we really care here. And there's some other pastors that really care. And at the bottom is the golden text of the Bible, John 3:16, okay? We never know what that one verse of Scripture will do. So please take these. If you can at all, I'd love to have all of you back for just 5 to 6 o'clock this evening for that Hour of Power youth rally, where we can really pray over the kids that are going to be here. Jared Coleman, a friend of ours, he's going to be speaking. He's going to bring a devotion or a sermon during that time. And we'll get the kids to sing. It'll be a time of worship for them. Now listen, I know what some of you think. Well, that's just for the kids. I won't be going. You know what you're saying? I don't want to hand out anything.
God bless you, Frank.
So you better grab some of these now on the way out. Because we have got... How many of you believe that our youth are important?
Amen.
How many of you, don't stick your hand up yet. How many of you want our youth to go to hell? How many of you want them to go to heaven?
Amen.
Well, then you won't have any trouble showing up and showing out for Jesus, putting that in a kid's hand. I know many of you are going to be working. You're not going to be able to do it. But for those that can, all we need is about 10 at each school. That's all we need, 10 people, just to hand them out. And so we can do that very easily, but we're going to need it during this evening service. We're going to need to pray over them, because I'm going to tell you that Matthew, you have an easy time witnessing at school. He has a tough time doing that, and he's a preacher. He needs help with that. He needs our prayers. So let's be here if at all possible. Anything? All right. Thank you for being here. 5 o'clock this evening, be praying. Also Monday through Friday, week 8 of the Christian Unity Revival. Listen, over 1 million people. I had people stopping me in Dollywood this week. Hey, we've been watching this meeting. I signed more autographs this week than I ever signed before in my life. I'm not kidding. But they were also getting all the other preachers' autographs too. But we really, I believe this is a God thing.
Yes, amen.
And it's very easy to do. You don't even have to say anything. All you got to do is hand it. But you could tell a kid you love them. You never know. I'll never forget reading the biography of D.L. Moody. And there was a kid one day when it snowed. And he was walking by all these other churches. And there was a pastor that's standing there. And he was standing out on the front. And he was smoking a pipe. And he said, "Son, where are you going?" He said, "I'm going to Moody's." He said, "Why do you walk past all these other churches to go on the other side of Chicago to church?" And that little boy turned back and said, "Because they love a fella over there." That's what I want right here. I want them to say, "They love a fella over there. They love a girl." Okay? We love you, visitors. Thank you. Let's get our hands in the air and exercise. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Have a great day. Happy Easter.